All right. You wanted me to give a little bit of my testimony?
Yes.
About Texas, or?
Just how you got started a little bit, brother. Add that
in. Oh, how I got started street preaching? Okay. Well, it was been some years ago. I got saved, and my testimony is on Facebook. I use Facebook as a bullhorn. And I got saved and served in a church, and it was a big mega church. Very large mega church. Pastor Aiden here, we were talking about that earlier, you know. And this pastor is a nationally well-known pastor. I'm not going to mention his name because I really don't need to. I got called to do street preaching by the Lord. And so we started at the very first thing we street preached at, and this was my first lesson in what it was really going to be like. I was leading a life group. I was involved in leadership at the church. I was a sentinel. I was a life group leader, and been doing it for a few years after I got saved. And the first person I led to Christ online. Actually, wow. Online. And I learned the power of the gospel through that. A man by the name of Conrad, who lived in Seattle, owned the largest pro-choice chat room website in the United States, one of the largest in the world, prochoicetalk.com. And it was the largest in the United States. This was back when chat rooms were pretty popular, you know. And I led him to Christ. He shut down the website.
Praise the Lord.
Shut down the website. It came back. Somebody else bought the domain name. It came back. It was dead. Never did the same. You go back on there now, it's the last post was like 4 years ago. No, it's completely dead.
Wow.
So I learned the power of the gospel by saving one person, how that one person can give their life to Christ.
Amen.
And they can change things. And this was a revelation to me. Amen. A huge revelation.
Amen.
And, okay. I have a hard time standing behind the pulpits. this was a huge revelation to me. And so the Lord called me to do street preaching. The first thing we street preached at was a Ku Klux Klan rally.
Ah.
We had a Ku Klux Klan rally come to Amarillo, Texas. They preached, I guess I should say. They did their little speeches out in front of City Hall, and they fenced them off. The police were there. A big crowd gathered up. And I was convinced we needed to go preach a message of love while they were preaching hate. Basically, that was our message. It was very simple. I had never really street preached before. And I was teaching this life group. We had about 15, 20 people in the life group. And they're all like, yeah, brother, let's go get them. And then one guy showed up.
Yeah.
It was perfect. Me and my wife and one guy showed up. And he wasn't even in the life group.
Really?
Everyone else had excuses. Oh, we couldn't make it. We were doing our hair, wash, whatever their excuses were, they didn't show up. So I had my first lesson on street preaching right there, that not many people are bold enough to do it.
Sure.
Then after that, we discovered the Swingers Club. In 2008, we discovered Swingers Club. And we found out through researching and putting stuff up online on a map, we did a prayer map of our city. And on this prayer map, we told people, look, if you're going to be the Air Force, right, for the street preachers, you need to have focus on where you're going to bomb. You know, where you're going to drop your bombs. You need targets to go after. So we put up sexually immoral places, porn shops, the Swingers Club. We put up false religions, Hinduism, Islam, all this other kind of stuff. And the compromised churches, the ones that were allowing sodomites to preach from behind the pulpits, or they were putting them in the worship team and all of that, and we put stick pins in them. And so in the midst of researching that, we found the Swingers Club. The Swingers Club is where they swap wives back and forth, and it's disgusting.
Wow.
Our senior pastor wrote a book called Marriage on the Rock, and it was a national bestseller in the Christian community. And he does a television show called Marriage on the Rock. And he's a TV personality. And anyway, I went to my church leadership and I said, look, we found this Swingers Club. We want to preach in front of it. You know, we want to go tackle this thing. And he said, well, you're a life group leader. Why don't you just make a life group out of it and just go out and preach on the streets? Great. So I got endorsement from the church, you know. What a great thing. So I gathered up a team. We gathered up some people from different churches, about two or three different churches. We took 40 Christians out in front of this swingers club. Mm. Our first night out on New Year's Eve, 2008. New Year's Eve, 2008, we are out there preaching, holding hands, preaching. We brought the news media with us because there's two things swingers club hate. They hate the gospel and they hate the light being shined on the darkness.
Right.
And after that happened, oh, my church patted me on the back. Great, you exposed them. I can't believe you found that. And then the news media started trashing us. And as soon as that started happening, I got called in late at night by the senior pastor and his wife. We were told, great, you did a good job. Pat you on the back. You found the swingers club. You exposed it. Good job. Leave it alone now.
Wow.
Stay away from it. Don't go there. Don't preach there. Let it go. Shut down your website. Shut down the ministry or get out of the church. Go somewhere else.
Wicked.
So we decided to go somewhere else. Here was a pastor whose nationally recognized calling on his life was the promotion of godly marriage, and the exact opposite was going on in this horrible, wicked place. And we got thrown out of the church for exposing it and preaching to it because the news media got involved and money was at stake.
Money.
Yep.
Money. For the love of money. All kinds of evil. So, after that, we got thrown out of the church, and my wife and I decided, you know what, we're just going to continue to street preach. We preached in front of that club for exactly 1 year. The Lord spoke to my son and told him, you'll preach there a year and get shut down. We preached that club exactly 1 year to the day. To the day, New Year's Eve 2009, that club shut down.
Praise the Lord.
Bankrupt. The bank repossessed the building, it split completely up, and it never came back.
Thank
you. It was completely gone. And the Lord showed me again the power of preaching in the culture. That,
yes.
That the God, it's not us. There are no great men of God. There is only men who serve a great God.
Amen.
But the spiritual warfare and the weapons that we wield are not our own. They come from the Lord. And the enemy of God cannot stand against them. I mean, King David went out and slayed Goliath.
Amen.
He was one man. This one Goliath giant stood against an army, but David was anointed by God. And he said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that defies the armies of the living God?
Right.
He was, as Brother Reuben said, some people think he was arrogant. He wasn't arrogant. He was confident in God. And he knew that God was going to fight this guy. That he was just going to be the vessel. And so he went and took him down. We knew exactly the same thing about Amarillo, Texas, about the Swingers Club. So we went on and doing our ministry. And we bounced around from church to church. And we did discipleship in our home. And I became an associate pastor of two different Assemblies of God churches. And was an adult Bible study teacher in a couple of different ones. And we continued to do street ministry, and then we got put on Southern Poverty Law Center's, you know, hate group list, like Brother Evan is, and probably a few of you in this room. But we continued to preach, and we continued to stay the course, and God has changed Amarillo, Texas. Let me tell you something. When we first started street preaching, Amarillo, Texas had 7 strip clubs. Albuquerque, New Mexico, which is 350,000 people, it's 150,000 more than Amarillo, had a total of 5. Lubbock had 2, and they're bigger than Amarillo as well. Amarillo had as many strip clubs as Albuquerque and Lubbock combined. You know how many strip clubs there are in Amarillo now? 1.
Right.
1. Because each and every one of them on that map started falling. Boom, 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 boom. We prayed over one that was Cheetahs. My wife hated that place more than any other. I don't know why, but she despised that particular one. She said, Lord, I pray you tear that one down. Guess what? Got bulldozed.
Wow.
It went out of business, went bankrupt. They bulldozed it down, and today it's a parking lot.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, right?
Thank you, Lord.
A lot of the things on the map went down. not just because people prayed, but because people were willing to go out and preach.
Amen.
Because people were willing to go out and do something for God. Because they weren't just wanting to sit down in their pews. And we had people come into our group and people that left our group. I'm sure Brother Reuben knows what that's like. They just come in and they go, they come in and they go. But we had a little team operating all the time. And we went from place to place and preached on all the places that we had on the map. We went from each to each one, and they started to come down. Boom, 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 boom. And they're still coming down, even after we left. God is still working because we were faithful enough to do that.
Amen.
So that's when we got started. Then we got called to Alaska, and I think the reason is because there were no street preachers up there. I mean, there's a little Baptist church that we preached with, and they'll go stand on the corners, and they'll hand out a few tracts, and they do a little bit of that, but there's nobody that would do open-air preaching. There was no one who had ever preached the Alaska Gay Pride for 39 years. I spoke the first year to one of the founding members of that group, of that bunch out there, that lesbian who started that thing 39 years ago, and she said, "We've never had street preachers until you showed up."
Oh boy.
No street preachers ever showed up until we got there. We took that little Baptist church with us. They went out there with us, and we preached it and ended up all over the news, and then they decided they didn't want to come out. You know the story. It goes on and on and on like that. So the Lord has called us up there now, and we're going to stay for a while. We're not going to be there permanently. But David Sane, that brother, is moving up there, and it looks like he's going to stay permanently. He and his wife. So there's going to be a permanent street preaching presence when we leave. We're hoping eventually to have three small teams. One for Juneau, one for Fairbanks, one for Anchorage. We live in Anchorage. And we're hoping to, you can, actually, if you've got street ministry teams in those three cities, you cover about 80% of the population of Alaska. Because Alaska is 2.5 times the size of the state of Texas, but its population is less than Fort Worth, Texas, the whole state. So you've got as many people in Fort Worth scattered out over an area 2.5 times the size of Texas. There's a lot of wilderness up there. I don't know if there's any bears needing. So nobody's, you know, there's a lot of places you're not going to have to preach. But there's also Jesse Morrell's friend. He goes to a lot of the villages, preaches a lot of the villages. So the villages are getting reached. And he's a preacher like Jesse Morrell. He preaches like Jesse, just doesn't do the colleges and doesn't do the street ministry like we do. But he goes to the villages and preaches the same kind of message. So anyway, that's a little bit about me and what we've been doing. I've been making a lot of videos. I know some of you guys have seen some of our videos that we've been putting up, and a few of them went viral, and we've reached quite a few people that way. But God continues to lead us, and we continue to keep working, and so we're going to just continue on doing what we're doing, and eventually I think the Lord's going to bring us back to Texas, or maybe somewhere else, I don't know.
Your wife said, don't forget about Girdwood.
Don't forget about Girdwood.
What your wife just said. Why?
Oh, don't forget about Girdwood. Oh, yeah, okay.
Wow, that's pretty good, brother.
Girdwood is a small section. It's considered part of Anchorage, but it's about 30 miles away. It's a little resort kind of town. It's got a ski resort there, and they have this big hippie festival every year called the Girdwood Forest Fair. And they have the big signs that says, no dogs, no politics, no religious orders.
Oh.
It used to say, no Jesus freaks, but they changed it to no religious orders because they didn't want Muslims there either. So,
wow.
So last year, we decided to go and preach there. We thought, oh, this sign is kind of some kind of a joke, right? No, it's not a joke. We went in there to hand out tracts, and I got bodily thrown out, literally physically carried out and tossed out by security. And the police came and threatened to arrest me. I got it on video. We filed a lawsuit with the Center for Religious Expression, and we got a preliminary injunction issued by the court, federal courts. So this year we went in and preached legally, and they could not throw us out.
Amen.
And they had about 8 security people surrounding us on the outside, watching us, videotaping the entire thing, and about a dozen protesters surrounding me and my wife,
wow,
beating on drums and doing all this. You should see the video. It's insane. And we're, all we're doing is handing out tracts.
Wow.
You know, we're just being very gentle because our policy is when we go to a new place, we don't go in six guns blazing. You know, we don't go in there and give them the full meal deal, the banner, the gold horns, and all of that. We prefer to go in gentle and see how they're willing to receive it. And so this is what we did the first year of the Gay Pride. And they assaulted us, so the next year, they got the full meal deal. They got the banners and the bullhorns, the rebukes and everything. I mean, we went in there and just blasted. But the same thing with Girdwood. We went in there with just tracts, or handing out tracts, and that's what they did. So guess what they're going to get next year? Yeah, they're going to get a little bit more aggressive. We're going to get a little more aggressive next year because they did not receive us gently. So apparently they're prideful. What does the Bible say? God gives grace to the humble, and he resists the proud. Right?
Yeah.
All some have compassion, making a distinction, others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating of the garments defiled by the flesh. What is the distinction? It's pride. Pride. Compassion for the humble, fear for the prideful. Because the man who doesn't have the fear of God needs the fear of God. It's not because you're trying to hammer him just to hammer him. You're actually giving him what he needs.
Right.
You can imagine a guy going down the street, right, and a homeless guy collapses on the street having a heart attack, and the guy's walking to his office carrying coffee and donuts. You're not going to offer the guy coffee and donuts, right?
Right.
He doesn't need that. He needs an ambulance. Give the man what he needs, right? Give the sinner what he needs. If he needs the fear of God, give him the fear of God. He's been beat up, and he's fearing for his life. He's got cancer. He's dying in the hospital. He's terrified. He doesn't need the fear of God. He needs the compassion. Right? So that's what we do. We make that distinction. I like to preach a very balanced kind of ministry where we can do compassion and we can also do the fear. We do both. I like to do both.